Hi, Park Hills family. I miss seeing you all. If you're like me, you're getting impatient with everything related to COVID-19. I understand introverts might love this. I know extroverts are going crazy. But I personally am very eager for us to assemble again as a local church body. Just know that we have been meeting and we'll continue to conduct meetings discussing the reopening of Park Hills. What I can share with you for certain is that no dates have been set. And when we do open, things will initially look very different than what you're used to. We're going to err on the side of caution. We're going to take precautions that are necessary and logical to keep everyone safe and well. We're going to encourage some of you who might be the most vulnerable to continue to tune in from home for worship. Please understand, we're not operating out of a position of fear, but rather of love. We want to be as kind and considerate as we can. Please know that when we do assemble again, we're going to have to extend each other a lot of grace. I can tell you already from the conversations that I've had that there are vastly different opinions on COVID-19 and everything that is related to it. So when we get together, we're going to be focusing on worshiping our Lord. That is going to be a time of celebration and not a time of arguing different ideas and opinions. While this continues, I want to encourage you to make sure you're using the time well. What a great time to be growing in our faith, to be spending more time reading God's word. We want to foster a stronger relationship with God. I want us to be thinking about how we can love God well, love others well, how we can be dependent on the Holy Spirit and dependent on prayer, how we can be living our lives as worship and lives that bear fruit for the kingdom of God. Wouldn't it be great to come out of the end of this with a stronger relationship with our Savior? Let's stay faithful until we can be together again.
Jesus, I love thee. I know thou art mine. For thee all the follies of sin I resign. My gracious Redeemer, my Savior art thou. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I love thee because thou hast first loved me and purchased my pardon on Calvary's tree. I love thee for wearing the thorns on thy brow. If ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. I'll love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath, and say, cold on my brow, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now. In mansions of glory and endless delight, if ever I love thee, my Jesus, 'tis now.
There is no song we can sing to honor the weight of your glory. There are no words we could speak to capture the depth of your beauty. Jesus, there's no one like you. Jesus, we love you, ever adore you. There's no one like you. Jesus, we love you, ever adore you, Lord. There is no sinner beyond the infinite stretch of your mercy. How can we thank you enough for how you have loved us completely? Jesus, there's no one like you. Jesus, we love you, ever adore you. There's no one.
there's no one like you. Jesus, we love you, ever adore you. There's no one like you. Jesus, we love you, ever adore you, Lord.
All we have, all
we may run, So you know what, Mark? You know what I think most Americans hate more than anything else?
What's
is
that?
The idea of waste, right? Americans hate waste. When we hear stories of waste, and it could be a waste of something intangible or something tangible, but Americans hate waste. Like, I was doing some reading this week, and the largest oil spill ever in the world was not actually an accident. It was during the Gulf War in 1991. Whoever was fighting just poured oil into the water and lit it on fire and left because they didn't want their enemies to come in. And they estimate like some 240 million gallons of oil poured into the Persian Gulf.
And caught on fire.
Yeah, and caught on fire.
Is that like your kitchen fire here at the church this week?
A little different, but it's close. It's close.
Alex had a mishap this week, but yeah, we aren't going to talk about it. But anyway, it's
hey,
okay.
You know what? Our kitchen is very clean right now. I'll tell you that. Yeah. But anyway, all this oil dumped in there for 3 months from like January to April, all this oil dumped in. We hate the idea of waste. And it could be something tangible like oil or even something intangible like a waste of talent, right? We all know athletes. We all have favorite athletes that are like, oh, that guy could have been so good, but he wasted his career. Either it's because he got in trouble with the law or drugs or something like that famous singers and entertainers that have wasted their lives or their careers or their talents because they threw it all away. Well, we're in our generosity series, and we're going to talk a little bit about a story of someone who wasted something. So in each of our generosity sermons, we've tried to bring out three things going on here. We've tried to see that God is generous, and we can believe in his generosity. And if we believe in his generosity, first we see his generosity, then we believe that he is generous, and then second, we live it out. We apply it to our lives. So we're looking at a story in Matthew chapter 25. It's the Jesus's parable of the talents. It's a well-known parable, but we're going to dig into this and see a guy who wasted some of his talents. And as we study this, context is essential. In chapter 24, verse 3, we see that Jesus is talking to his disciples here. His disciples come and they say, hey, how are we going to know when you're coming back? And Jesus says, well, let me tell you a story. And he tells actually a bunch of stories, and he talks to them quite a bit, and he talks about his return. So the main theme going on here is that we need to be ready, or Jesus' disciples need to be ready for his return. So we're going to explore what being ready looks like. Not this idea that, oh, Jesus is coming, look busy, but what God asks us to do while we wait for him.
You know, Alex, what I've been doing lately while I wait for this COVID-19 to end is annoy myself.
Yeah, me too.
I mean,
annoy myself, not you, annoy me.
Are you sure?
Let's just get that clear.
But I find myself doing something that I actually have disdain for, and that is I've been doing a lot of armchair quarterbacking. And I don't like that idea, but it's this idea that now all of a sudden I have opinions on all this stuff related to COVID-19. Why are they doing this? I think about what the leaders' decisions are, and you know, I keep doing this. And the truth told, if I'm honest, I'm actually really glad that it's not my decision to make that could affect lives, that could affect the economy, whether or not there's chaos or growth or even just be in a position of making decisions that no matter what you decide, somebody's going to disagree with.
Right.
I think that the people that God allows to be in positions of control, we have to remember that he put them there. And they're accountable to him for how they make those decisions. I think people like me need to criticize less and pray more. Today's parable actually talks about leadership, and we see some interesting things in leadership that will probably cause us to realize it's a pushback on us a little bit. So we're going to be in Matthew 25 in a minute, but let's pray before we begin. Heavenly Father, we commit this to you. We ask you to be in our midst, no matter where we are watching from. God, I thank you that you know exactly the condition of each of our hearts. You know what we need to hear. You know in what ways we're hurting or rejoicing. And Father, would you just meet with each of us today? May your Spirit move mightily and speak through us today. And Lord, we commit it to you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Matthew 25, starting in verse 14. For it will be like a man going on a journey who called his servants and entrusted to them his property. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1, each according to his ability. Then he went away. He who had received 5 talents went at once and traded with them, and he made 5 talents more. So also the one with 2 talents made 2 talents more. But he who had received 1 talent went and dug in the ground and hid his master's money. Let's make some observations here first. We've got a wealthy landowner in the story, and in that time, a wealthy landowner would have delegated some of the responsibility of his resources to people he would trust. And with that delegation, there was an expectation of multiplication. You're going to do well with it. Might have been too much for him to handle personally, and trusted servants would be like trusted employees. They were stewards. They were to be managers of the master's resources. And if it goes well, everybody benefits in a proper situation. Now, the nature of travel in that day made for a lot of uncertainties. Obviously, just the fact that he was traveling speaks to his wealth, because most people would have been staying right where they were working so they could provide for their families that day. He had the wealth to travel, and travel in those days was not like GPS of now, where you know exactly when you're going to arrive. There was so much uncertainty to it. Then he entrusts these talents to people, and the value of a talent varied from place to place to some degree. And talent is really kind of an unfortunate word for our language, because it kind of leads us astray. It's easily misinterpreted. The term talent actually has its origin for us from this parable, and that's where we got it. But it's really a measurement of money, and that's important to understand. It's a weight of precious metals that were typically silver. You've also got 3 servants here given different amounts based on their ability, each according to their own ability. And it kind of raises the question of fairness a little bit.
Right, because it doesn't seem like a completely equitable situation, right? So one guy gets 5, one guy gets 2, and one guy ends up with 1. Why do you think one guy got 5 times as many as a different servant?
Yeah, I mean, it certainly speaks to how we define fairness. I mean, the simple fact is, the text clearly mentions that they were each given according to their ability.
So what would be their ability in this situation? What ability is that talking about?
I think we've got to take it right from the text here and say it's clear that it was the ability to handle the master's money well.
Yeah, so that brings up, at this point, we could question the master, why the 2, why the 5, why the 1. He sees that in their ability. Is that fair? I think, like you're saying, Mark, it doesn't really matter what's fair, because it's up to the master to make that decision, right? And I think if we look at ourselves today and we say, man, why don't I have what someone else has? That could be the resources we have, the money, the car, the house, but it could also be the position, the power that we have in a community, the influence, or even the charm and the intellect and the what we have as a personality. We could see that in other people and say, well, why don't I have that? And I think what this passage starts to tell us is that it's not so much about having the equal things, because equal results are not asked for. What's asked for is being faithful with what we've been given. So we've been entrusted with something, and we are called to not produce the same results, but to be faithful with what we've been given. They've been given different amounts. So this makes me think of my kids. I have I have three boys, a five, a three, and a one-year-old, and we have a bedtime routine at night, and I always send them to bed and say, go get ready for bed. And each one, I have a different expectation right. of what they're going to do. So my five-year-old can mostly get ready all by himself, where my one-year-old, if he just goes to his bedroom, you know, that's good enough for me. I can get him ready for bed from there. But what that illustrates is that I don't expect the same results from them when I say, go get ready for bed. What I expect is for them to obey and be faithful to the best of the ability that they have. And that's why I give them an expectation. And so for us, that completely kills the comparison game, right? We can't compare ourselves with other people. Well, if I only had that position of leadership, I would be able to. Or if I only had that type of influence, I'd be able to do that type of ministry. Or if I only had those resources, that house, that car, lived in that neighborhood, that's not important. What's important is that we're faithful to our calling. See, Rick Warren, he's a pastor out in California, has a great illustration about giving, and he talks about how he gives a large portion of his income to ministry, and part of that is he's written a book, and he makes lots of money from that book, but he says people come to him all the time, and they say, Rick, if I wrote a book and made the money that you made, I'd be willing to give away as much as you did. And he says, no, you wouldn't, because you aren't doing it now. You're not being faithful to give generously now. He says, I've been giving generously for 37 years. I've been giving in ways that, and he doesn't say it in a way that's prideful, but just the truth of he's been working on giving in his whole life. And so that teaches us that we can't compare ourselves to others. What we can do is be faithful to the call. So moving on in our passage here, there's clearly an intended parallel between the landowner going away and Jesus leaving. That's what Jesus is telling his disciples. He's leaving them with resources, and he's expecting them to use that faithfully. And so he's leaving them. The master left his servants, and then he comes back. So let's look at this next couple verses to see what happens when the master comes back.
Yeah, let's pick it up in verse 19. Now, after a long time, the master of those servants came and settled accounts with them. And he who had received the five talents came forward, bringing five talents more, saying, Master, you delivered to me five talents. Here I have made five talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. And he also who had the two talents came forward, saying, Master, you delivered to me two talents. Here I have made two talents more. His master said to him, Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the joy of your master. These two servants here are really, the first two are players here.
Oh, yeah.
They get it. And that's the kind of servant you want. And evidently the master knew this about them, and that's why he entrusted them with as much as he did. I don't know about you, Alex, but sometimes I struggle to trust people or to entrust things to people. One of the times maybe it's hardest to trust is when I'm in a chair tilted back and there's this little drill coming toward my teeth.
You've been there a lot?
Yeah, that's not my most favorite time to have to trust someone, but you have to in those moments. You just can't get away with not doing that. Maybe you're struggling right now with trusting the CDC or politicians. We're hearing so much from them right now, and it's a little bit time to kind of question them. What in the world's going on? Maybe you, as you're watching, you struggle with trusting pastors. And that's a reasonable thing. I mean, are pastors being true to the word? I love the Evangelical Free Church because they have this way of functioning that says, where stands it written? In other words, the decisions we make as a denomination or as a movement have to do with what the word of God says. And that's what we want to go by. And sadly, too many churches and too many pastors have devalued the Bible over time and put culture and different ideas ahead. And to me, they lose their trustworthiness. So it's reasonable to think of. That's why we want you to know the word of God. So that way when they hear something that's not right, you know it. The master trusted these servants, and the first servants clearly made wise use of the resources he had given them. I can't help but think, though, wouldn't they have been scared? That's a lot that they're trusted with, and they're scared of failure, and there's obviously some serious expectations on the part of the master. I mean, he's going away, but he's coming back. So imagine the thought and consideration that had gone into what they decided to do. Perhaps they'd been to the marketplace with the master and they'd watched him deal and negotiate. Maybe they were thinking they could do that. They're talking about the pros and cons and all the risks. And add to that, it's not your money. It's you're risking someone else's money. It had to be stressful.
Yeah, I mean, imagine the stress that these guys would feel, right? They're working and they're waiting for the master. And it's not like he had a cell phone and he could call them and be like, hey, I'm coming right now. So you have this servant looking out and he sees the master coming in and he's like, oh no, it's time. And his heart starts racing. But you have the first two guys who are probably seeing that and they're like, oh man, like, This is exciting. I can't wait till he comes. And I mean, I can just imagine them coming before the master and they know that the day of accounting is coming, right? They know there's a day of reckoning that was implied when he gave them the money. And so the first guy comes up and he says, hey master, you gave me five. And he puts five on the table and he says, oh, but wait. And he pulls out another and he puts that on the table. He says, I got you another. And the master's like, great. And wait a second. And he slaps two on there. He says, I got you another. And another, and another, and another. He's got five. And the master sees this and is overjoyed. He doesn't just say, wow, you're a great servant. He says, enter into my joy with me.
Yeah.
Yeah, and then the second guy does the same thing. Like, master, you gave me these two. Here, look, I got you another, and here's another. And the master loves that, and he says, oh, enter into my joy with me. And so you have this great story of these first two guys interacting. Imagine just the confidence in presenting the money when they brought double. They were significant, or they were faithful with what they were given, and the master invites them in. Yeah. So then we're going to pick up the story in verse 24. So read along with me in verse 24, and we're going to see what the third guy did. It says this. It says, he also who had received the one talent came forward saying, master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you scattered no seed. So I was afraid and I went and I hid your talent in the ground. Here, you have what is yours. But his master answered him, you wicked and slothful servant. You knew that I reap where I have not sown and gathered where I scattered no seed. Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and at my coming I should have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has the 10 talents. For to everyone who has, more will be given, and he will have an abundance. But from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. And cast the worthless servant into the outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Wow.
Intense.
It's completely different.
Absolutely intense. It's interesting to me, this statement that the third servant, the master, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you had not scattered seed. And so I was afraid. I mean, what do we do with that? First of all, because Jesus is teaching his disciples about faithfulness, and he's using this parable to do so, we might be tempted to draw a hard parallel between the master and God himself. And that's not necessarily appropriate for the purpose of the parable to be achieved. So whether the servant's statement was an accurate moral assessment or more of a business observation about how he operated, it's not really the point. Think about the intensity of that statement from the master, you wicked and slothful servant. If you knew this and did nothing, why is he upset? It's a waste, wasted opportunity.
Yeah.
So what does he do? Take the talent from the one who has 10 and give it, from the one who has the one and take it and give it to the one who has 10. Like, wow. For those servants of God who use his gifts and opportunities, God will give them even more. First Peter chapter 4 says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another as good stewards of God's varied grace. From the master's perspective, this guy's no good, and there's no reason to keep him around.
Yeah, but if you think about it from the servant's perspective, right? Like, there's a lot at stake here. He's talking about the master's money. The master would obviously be very upset if he came back. And imagine he tried to invest the money and he lost it. So, I mean, I understand that the master is furious, but from the servant's perspective, like, I can kind of understand why he was afraid.
You think about it, the master is mad because no effort was made. He didn't try anything. He didn't take any risk. He didn't adventure out. He just did something very simple. No creative attempts to do anything.
Yeah, but I mean, that's a huge risk to his security, because upsetting the master would certainly lead to punishment. At least he played things safe, right?
But a wasted opportunity makes the master mad. You think about it. He really would have been safer to dig his own hole and put it in. He would know where it was, and nobody could steal it, not even a servant. But it was a wasted opportunity.
Yeah, so the master isn't as mad that money was lost, because he got his one talent back. He was mad that he wasn't faithful to what the master had called him to do. The opportunity was wasted. He had a calling, and he traded in the service that was required of him for his own personal security.
Yep. Yeah, he wasted an opportunity just to be safe. He was thinking only of himself, and the master was very displeased.
Yeah. So turning toward us, how often do we do the same thing? We trade in the service that God has called us to do for our own personal security. Right? Think about Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. We talk about this verse all the time, right? For it is, by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not of yourselves, it's a gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. We love that verse, but we forget about verse 10, right? For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which Christ prepared in advance for us to do.
Yeah.
We are called to obey and do what Christ has asked us to do. See, we can't substitute the service that God has called us to do for our own personal security, because that's really what it comes down to with this servant. He didn't want to risk his own personal security, so he didn't serve the master. What are we created and blessed to do? We're created and blessed to obey God, to do what God's called us to do. And because of that, because sometimes we don't do that, I think we miss out in the joy of service. Service and serving God brings us joy. So what is our takeaway from this teaching of Jesus? Well, in the last parable, Jesus talked to his disciples about being watchful and expectant. And now this parable is about how to be ready for his return. So our duty to be ready for his return is to carry out the responsibility that Christ has given us faithfully. See, our reward is not a life of ease and luxury. And sometimes as Americans, we think about this. We say, oh, if I can just work hard to a certain point, then I'll be able to relax. And that's American culture. That's American dream, right? But that's not generosity. And we see that with the way the master deals with the third servant and the first servant, right? When he says, take away his one talent and give it to the guy who has 10. Well, how did that guy get 10? Well, obviously the master gave him his 10 back, right? Because the first servant brings the 10 and he says, here's my 10. So what does the master do? He gives it back to him. Now, that wouldn't be a reward. You wouldn't say, hey, take my 5, work at it, and I'll give you everything back as your reward. He's given him 10 to continue
to be faithful.
Faithfully serving, yeah, with that 10. And so he takes the one from the guy and he says, hey, I expect continued stewardship of this. It's ongoing. It doesn't end at some point. And so he gives that to the guy, and he says, I am expecting you to continue.
Yeah. The master is a good steward because he chooses good stewards and rejects ones that aren't.
And he's good at it.
He is.
Yeah.
Do you ever armchair quarterback God? I think we all do that sometimes. You know, I started out talking about armchair quarterbacking, just leaders or whatever, but Sometimes we do that with God. And I think when it comes to this subject and any kind of thing that looks like inequitable to us, it's why did God bless this person with that ability? I wish I had that. Or why did he bless them with that spiritual gift or the family they're in or whatever advantages they might seem to have. And we kind of are armchair quarterbacking God. We're saying that doesn't seem fair. We're doubting his wisdom. But the key thing here is that it's the master's call to make. Mm-hmm. God gets to decide who he gives what and to whom he chooses. And remember Jesus' parable in Matthew chapter 20. You've got the vineyard owner who he hires some people in the morning. And he commits to pay them a certain amount to work the whole day. But then he finds more people, hires them a little bit later in the day. And then he finds some more people who, even later in the day. And when it came time to pay them, he paid them all the same amount. Well, you imagine how people respond. They're all upset because they think, if I work longer, I should get more. And the answer from that master was, am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? In other words, it's the master's call to make. If someone has more than you or seems more gifted than you, that's God's issue. And that individual will be held responsible mm-hmm. for what they've been given and entrusted with. To whom much is given, much will be required. I go back to that all the time. And that's so essential for us to understand because it's not that you're just given all this stuff so that you can bless your own life. It's you're entrusted with it to be faithful with it and you'll be held accountable for it. It's a big deal.
Yeah, and the call here then is to be faithful, right? And that's our job as Christ followers is to be faithful what God has given to us. So, you know, think about that. When is the last time you have taken account of what God's given you and said, have I been faithful with what I have? Have I been faithful with the resources that God's given me? Those could be physical resources, again, like the money you have or the car you own or the house you live in, but it could also be intangible resources, the influence and power that you have in certain communities or in your place of work or things like that. Maybe the intellect that you have. Have you taken account of that and said,
spiritual gifts?
Yeah, spiritual gifts that God has given you. Are you using those spiritual gifts? Because what it comes down to is, what do you want God to say to you? Right? Because there are two responses to the servants here. Yeah. The ones who were faithful were told, well done, good and faithful servant, enter into my joy. Not be happy for me, enter into my joy.
Yeah.
But what was the other response? The other response was,
you wicked and lazy servant.
Wicked and, man, could you imagine being called a wicked and lazy servant by anyone? But that's what we're told. There's two options here. So what do you want to hear the Lord say to you when it's all said and done?
This comes back to the fact that we are managers, not owners. And we're to be stewards of what God has given us. And that comes true in the church as well. As pastors, we are to steward the church well, the church's resources, our time, the ministries. And churches can get out of line on this really easy. Sometimes we can get focused on the wrong things and we're so budget conscious that it's like we think, oh, if the church has a lot of money in the bank when the Lord comes, we're going to say, look how good we were with your money. And the Lord's going to go, what about all the missed opportunities? You know, and so we really have to be ready for the fact that we're going to be accountable for those kind of decisions. And when it comes to the church, it's not a business. It's not personal finances.
Thank the Lord it's not, right?
Yeah, really. It's the Lord's, and the bottom line is, it's all about the kingdom of heaven and doing that which helps out the kingdom and being good stewards of it. You know, we can't talk about the subject without thinking about that question of how we want it to end. When my life is nearing its end, when I look back over what I've done and what I've done with what I've been entrusted with, how do I want to see that? And I don't want to have regrets and wish I would have done something different. I mean, the parable is about the use of the master's resources And if you are a Christian and you know Jesus as your Savior, everything that you have, everything that you are, it's all His. And we've got to keep that in perspective because it helps us be generous with it.
Yeah, and it makes us think, what is God calling us to? What is God asking us to take and to risk? And if we're putting our trust or in our security and we're trading our own security for the service God wants, that's not gonna please the Lord. And you know, maybe a good diagnostic for whether or not you do this is even recently, like, what happened to your 401k this last month, right? And if that was like a, oh no, like there's a loss of security, like all that in there is God's anyway. Yeah. And he can provide for you. And are you taking the resources? I mean, that's just one diagnostic. You can run 100 diagnostics on the different areas of your heart. That's an area of my heart that I can easily just, I can look at what I'm looking at with my money and say, oh man, am I giving this to the Lord or not? That's one that I can work on. But what is God prompting you to do? What maybe risk, what security is he asking you to give up so that you can serve him? Because one thing, getting in the game leads to joy when we serve. I've never met a generous person who's been like, man, I just hate being generous.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just, oh man.
They enjoy it.
Yeah, all those people that I've been generous with either with my finances or with my service, oh man, I hate that. Nobody's ever said that, right? It leads to joy. And a reminder that our master is returning. Mm. He left and is on a long journey. Jesus is not on earth right now, but he said he's coming back. We know he's coming back. Yeah. And we're entrusted to accomplish the task that he has set for us. What is that task? Well, you know, we just read Acts 1:8, right? You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses. That is at the most basic level. There's our task to make disciples.
You know, I want to circle back finally to joy. And not only are we to do this, we to be good stewards of it, but be joyful about it. Do it with the right attitude. Don't do it as, oh, I've got to do that. You know, no, it's that idea of realizing that we're stewards of what God has given us, and he's blessed us with it, and now we give it back, and we do it with joy. What does Jesus tell us that the master says to the faithful servants? Well done, good and faithful servants. You have been faithful over a little. I will set you over much. Enter into the what? The joy of your master. You know, Alex, there's so many joyless people in our world.
Yeah. You see it now, right?
Oh, it's amplified. And you think about it. They're trying to create joy with stuff or people around them or control of their circumstances, and it's not working. And what's interesting about what Jesus calls us to do with generosity, it's counterintuitive to our culture. Jesus is saying, live open-handed. Don't live with this idea of pulling it all in. Everything you have has been given you from God, so give it back. Serve with it. Recognize it's not yours to begin with, and find true joy. That's amazing. In Jesus' parable, he says it twice to those two servants. Enter into your master's joy. Maybe if joy has been missing in your life, it might have to do with this very subject right here. Would you pray with me? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word and what it has to say on this subject. Lord, first of all, we recognize very quickly that you are a generous God. You didn't have to give us what you've given us, and we thank you. And we recognize that your generosity is a beautiful thing, and you want us to then apply it. And Lord, forgive us for the times when we've adopted this idea that everything we've received or that we have or that we are is just for us. Father, that's such a North American ideal, and help us to reject that and to embrace your truth that says we are just stewards of what we have and what we've been given and who we are. And help us to live open-handedly with a desire to remain faithful until our Savior returns. So we can hear those words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the Master's joy." Father, may we maintain joyfulness in the meantime. May we discover the joy of living open-handed. And Father, may your kingdom advance as a result. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.